As already mentioned, this work is a joint work with my PhD supervisor, Alexander May, and it is called Maximizing Small Root Bounds by Linearization, which is itself quite surprising because we can use such a simple thing as linearization to obtain quite good results. And the subtitle Applications to Small Secret Exponent, RSA, this is what I'm going to be talking about during this talk. So let's maybe start. Small Secret Exponent, RSA. Well, the RSA system is as usual defined by some public parameters N and E, and a secret parameter D. The encryption works by taking a message M and raising it to the eth power to obtain a ciphertext, and decryption similarly works by taking the ciphertext and raising it to the dth power to reveal the message again. So if you think about something like low-cost devices, you might be tempted to speed up the process of decryption. So what options do we have for that? Well, one simple method to speed up the decryption is to use a small parameter d, because then we don't have to do that much exponentiations to compute the message from the ciphertext. But it has already been shown by Michael Wiener in 1990 that if we choose the parameter d to be smaller than n to the power of 0.25, then this is insecure, which means we can reconstruct the parameter d by just using the public parameters. And this result has been further improved by lattice-based techniques from Bonney and Durfee in 1999. And they showed that it is insecure if d is smaller than n to the power of 0.292. And, well, what other options for speeding up the decryption process do we have? We might as well use the Chinese remainder theorem, because the party who knows the secret parameter d also knows the factorization of the modulus n. So what we can do is we can compute c to the power of dp modulo p, where dp is just d modulo p minus 1, and the second value c to the power of dq modulo q, and combine those values by the Chinese remainder theorem to obtain c to the power of d modulo n. And if you use this Chinese remainder theorem, RSA, we might be tempted to use additionally small parameters dp and dq, such that this is even faster. But Ellen Jochems and Alexander May showed in 2007 that if we choose those parameters dp and dq to be smaller than n to the power of 0.073, then this is also insecure, which means again we can reconstruct those parameters. And what is the contribution of this talk? Well, in this talk we want to investigate the results of Bonney and Durfee on the one hand, and on the other hand the results of Jochems and May. And for Bonney and Durfee we will present a simplified proof technique, because for those of you who know the proof of this result, it's not that easy, but in a minute you will see that we can formulate it very simply. And in the second part of this talk, we will investigate an open question posed by Jochems and May about the possibility to improve this upon this result by using something similar like Bonney and Durfee. Okay, so let's start with the attack of Bonney and Durfee, and let us look at how this works. We start with the RSA key equation, which is E times D is congruent to 1 modulo phi of n. And this can also be written as 1 plus a factor k for the modulus times the expansion of phi of n. I've written it here as n plus 1 plus minus p minus q. And now let's introduce two variables, a variable x for the value k and a variable y for the value minus p minus q. And for the term n plus 1, let's write capital A. Then if we take this equation and reduce it modulo e, then we obtain we obtain a polynomial equation 1 plus ax plus xy equals 0 modulo e. And from the point of view of an attacker, if we can, maybe I say this at first, this polynomial on the left-hand side, the 1 plus ax plus xy, we know that this polynomial has a root, namely the value x0, y0 equal to k and minus p minus q modulo e. And if an attacker is able to find this root, well, then using minus p minus q, we are able to factor the modulus, so we can say that this RSA is broken. Bonnet and Durfee employ the technique presented by Coppersmith to find small solutions to polynomial equations, and using this method, we are able to find roots of some polynomial equation which are upper bounded by some values capital X and capital Y. And because it is an integral part of this talk, I would like to give you a short idea of how the algorithm of Coppersmith works. So first of all, we start by defining some collection of polynomials which all share the common root that we are looking for, modulo some integer, some value e to the power of m for some integer m. And the first thing to notice here is that if we take a bunch of polynomials from this collection, a linear combination of a bunch of polynomials from this collection, then this polynomial, this linear combination, has also the same root. So now our goal is to find a special linear combination, namely one such that for all values small x smaller than capital X and y smaller than capital Y, it should hold that g evaluated at those points is smaller than e to the power of m, and this modulus that we defined above. Because what do we know then? Then we know that on one hand, because that's how we chose the polynomials, we have g x0 y0 evaluates to 0 modulo e to the m. And on the other hand, because we defined the linear combination to be, let me say, small, we know that g evaluated at that point is smaller than e to the power of m, and those two points combined give that g evaluated at x0 and y0 is 0, not only modulo e to the power of m, but over the integers. And when we apply Coppersmith's algorithm to find such a root, well, the ultimate goal is to maximize these upper bounds on the variables. And the maximization process is usually done by tweaking the collection of polynomials that we take in the beginning. So maybe let me give you an example for this. So this example refers to the Bonnet and Durfee attack. So on the right-hand side, you see the polynomial again that we wish to find solutions for. And we take a collection which consists of polynomials, which consists of the constant polynomial e, x times e, f, y times e, and y times f. And notice that all these polynomials share the common root that we're looking for, modulo e. So we took the integer m to be 1 here. Okay, and what we do to find the linear combination that we're looking for, we employ lattice techniques. So we take the polynomials as basis vectors of a lattice. Actually, to be more precise, we take the coefficient vectors of the polynomials to be basis vectors of a lattice, and this looks something like this. If you take the rows here, you see the coefficient vectors of the polynomials that we have in our collection, and each entry in this vector corresponds to one monomial. So the columns of this matrix correspond to the monomials that appear in this collection, and these columns are further scaled by the capital X and capital Y, but that's not so important here. What is important, in order to find a polynomial that fulfills our requirement to be let's say small again. We have to derive some condition on the determinant of this lattice. So we need to be able to compute the determinant. Well, in this case, the determinant of the lattice is equivalent to the determinant of the basis matrix, and this is just the product of the entries on the diagonal, because we have a triangular lattice basis. So if we go on with the algorithm, it puts out some bounds on capital X and capital Y, up to which we can find the solution to the initial polynomial. Well, Bonney and Durfee noticed that if we take just a subset of this collection, we actually improve the bound. So for this very example, if we remove the polynomial y times e, we get a superior bound on the bounds capital X and capital Y. But the problem that occurs is that this basis matrix now is no longer triangular, and it's not that simple to compute the determinant of the corresponding lattice. What is actually done is, to give you an intuition, so you have to multiply the contributions from the Gram-Schmidt orthogonalization, and here for the last basis vector, you somehow see, okay, the contribution of the xy squared is probably much larger and is the dominating term over the contribution of the y. But to get this shown rigorously is quite involved. So especially if you think about taking a collection which is not fixed as here, but for some parameterized collection where we take the parameter m to be not fixed but variable, then this gets very complicated. And this is exactly where our new technique comes into play. And this technique has been presented at last year's AsiaCrypt, and it's called unraveled linearization. And it basically works in three steps, the first of which is performing a linearization on the initial polynomial. So if we take the polynomial from Bonney-Durfee's attack, 1 plus xy plus ax, we perform a linearization, which is shown here by gluing together the terms 1 and xy. And let's call this polynomial f bar. The second step is to build a lattice basis, just like before. But notice that we take here the collection C prime, which is exactly the collection that was suggested by Bonney and Durfee for the improved bound. So we already removed the one polynomial y times e here. And the last step of unraveled linearization, well, as the name suggests, is to unravel the linearization. Well, what does that mean? Remember that in the first step, we introduced a new variable u for the term y plus 1 plus x times y. Well, we can write this, we can solve this for xy, and this gives xy equals to u plus u minus 1. And now the trick is, when building the lattice basis in the second step, every time you encounter a monomial x times y, you replace it simply by u minus 1. Okay, how does this look like? Let's look at the example. Okay, here's the collection C prime that we were just talking about. And we start by plugging in the coefficient vectors of the polynomials. Okay, so far, no problem. But in Bonney and Durfee's approach here, for the last polynomial, the problem occurred where we no longer had the triangular basis matrix. Well, let's see what happens here when we take the polynomial y times f bar. If we plug in f bar, we get u equal to y times u plus ax is uy plus a times xy. And now remember the replacement that we suggested. And if we plug this in here and multiply it out, we get u times y plus a times u minus a. And if you write this now in the lattice basis, you see that the only new monomial that occurs is u times y, so we have a perfectly triangular lattice basis. And once again, let's compare this with the approach of Bonney and Durfee. The contributions of the first three polynomials, well, it's pretty much the same. Notice all the contribution to the determinant in each case. Notice also that the upper bound u on the left-hand side is, from the size, is speaking of size, pretty much equivalent to x times y. And, well, as our intuition suggested in the case of Bonney and Durfee, on the right-hand side, the dominating term, the x times y squared, is just transferred to a u times y, and the, let's say, error term y does not appear anymore in our new lattice spaces. So let's summarize this Bonney and Durfee attack in short. Okay, the original analysis was very complicated because we had the non-triangular basis matrix, and there were several approaches to make this more simple, but none of them were. And in the new analysis, using the unraveled linearization, results in a perfectly triangular lattice basis. And so we may say this is a very simple and natural analysis. And now for the second part of the talk, I would like to look at another application of this unraveled linearization, namely in the case of RSA with CRT exponents. Well, in that case, we start with the two key equations, e times dp is congruent to 1 modulo p minus 1, and e times dq is congruent to 1 modulo q minus 1. Similarly, we can resolve the modulo operation by introducing two new variables, k and l. And for this system on the right-hand side, we transform this system on the right-hand side into a single equation by doing the following. We take the RSA equation, n is equal to p times q, solve this for p, and plug it in the first equation. And finally, from the system of those two equations, we eliminate the variable q. And this results in one equation, one quite large equation in four unknowns. And the problem is now to find a solution of this equation. Jochums and Mai did so in their crypto work from 2007, and they showed that we can find a solution if dp and dq are both smaller than n to the power of 0.073. But they observed a strange thing, namely they observed that their experimental results were better than suggested by the theoretical analysis. So their conjecture was, maybe we can do something like Bonney and Durfee by taking just a subset of the collection of polynomials to improve this bound. But unfortunately, or fortunately for me, they were not able to do so. And let's see what happens if we take the unraveled linearization. Okay, we start with exactly the same polynomial they did, and now we introduce a new variable for each monomial that occurs here. Not for each monomial. We glued together the terms as can be seen here. And so this gives us here five equations defining the newly introduced variables. And if we look at those five equations, if we count the unknowns, we get nine unknowns. So we try to eliminate the, let's say, old variables, dp, dq, k, and l. And if we do so, if we eliminate those, we get a relation between the new variables. And you see, this is slightly more complex than in the case of Bonney and Durfee. But what we do is pretty much the same each time when building up the lattice spaces, each time we encounter the monomial VWX, we replace it by the term on the right-hand side. And as it turns out, in this case, the theoretical analysis perfectly matches the experimental data. To show you this on a on a small graphic, we see the dashed line is the result from Jochems and Mai, where I plotted the bound for dp and dq that we can achieve for specific lattice dimension. And our new approach is the blue line, which is drawn above. And yeah, you see this is for all lattice dimensions a little bit better, and this also has a little bit more practical influence, because this is pretty much all of lattice dimension that is achievable in practice. So, and here for each lattice dimension we are quite a bit better. So we might say that the unravelled linearization captures the sublattice structure, the sublattice being just the removing of some of the polynomials in the collection. But unfortunately, if you draw those two lines into infinity for lattice dimension going to infinity, the asymptotic result is not improved. So, different from the case of Bonney and Durfee, we were not able to achieve a better result, but as I just said, for practical applications, this might really be good. Yeah. So, all right, let's quickly summarize what we have. Showed you some applications of unraveled linearization to small secret exponent RSA. We started with Bonney-Durfee attack on small parameter D, and we may say that it used to have a very complicated analysis, and now using this unraveled linearization it became very simple and very natural. And in the second part we looked at the Jochems-Mai attack on RSA CRT, and we can say that we closed the gap between the theoretical and experimental results. And unfortunately, we answered the question about improving the bound in the negative. Well, what can we say about unraveled linearization in general? I think it's a very simple technique, and it is probably useful in many other lattice-based attacks. So, thank you.